wonderful presentations on education, and I think you will find some parallels but also some differences in this. What I'll do is I will do an overview presentation, and based on some of our earlier work, which was in the area of health and also in the midday meal program of the school health services. But I'm not presenting that data there, but a lot of the learnings were interesting. So what I'm going to really begin with is to look at what is this idea of public goods, which essentially has been seen as the responsibility of the state. And in fact, when you read the literature on the welfare state and its theories surrounding the welfare state, the understanding was that it would minimize the role of markets in the provisioning of social services. And I really put this period post-1970s, where there was a contestation and an onslaught on the idea of welfareism itself. And welfareism was seen to limit individual choice and created dependencies. And this is very important, because when we look at why were expenditures cut, much of the rationale for this came from this kind of an ideological position, and that it was an unproductive investment. So the essential movement was to cut back on public investments and a greater role for the market. Now I see new public management and neoliberalism really providing the conceptual underpinnings for the rationale and architectures of PPPs. And therefore, I mean, we had a discussion in the morning, what was so different pre 1991 and post 1991, and I think the really the circulation of both neoliberal ideology and the new public management tools, in a sense, really redefined the role of the private and its collaboration with the public. And I think that is a very important aspect that we need to keep in mind. And I'm going to really look at how PPPs as an institutional arrangement created possibility to restructure the public. And I think we heard some of this in the morning presentations through the introduction of market principles. And so the concept I'm really going to use is commercialization, which I think may be a more appropriate concept for analyzing PPPs. And I really draw on the work of Marin McIntosh, who is a UK-based economist, and who works and built her understanding of commercialization, especially in the health sector, from Polanyi's work, who is a Polish economist. And he, see, so when you're looking at commercialization, both privatization and marketization are in a sense very much a part of commercialization. But why I like the concept of commercialization is it kind of helps you to analyze the various forms of market relations and how they coexist and reconfigure all these three sectors. And so, you know, in a sense, alluding to what you raised about, is there a boundary between for-profit and non-profit? In some situations there may be, but in some situations they haven't. They have been reconfigured. And the other thing is that we are not just looking at structure, but I think we are also looking at behavior of institutions. So how do institutions change? And you, several of you alluded to it this morning, where you said that the entire behavior of institutions, the values you espouse, and the contradictions and conflicts of values when you forge these partnerships. In fact, Michael Wright's work in the health becomes particularly pertinent, where he talks about the oppositional values in public-private partnerships and how they create tensions and conflicts. So in the health sector, this this concept helps us to examine the place of PPP in what I see is in a continuum of commercialization. So I'm just going to present this rest of this presentation and put it into three thematic areas: policies of PPPs, the practice, and the outcomes. In the policy, as I mentioned, I'm specifically using the word collaboration rather than a partnership. And there has always been that relationship in the health sector between the market and the state. Most collaborations in the initial stages in the 50s and the 60s was restricted to national health programs. Family welfare was one of the very important sites of collaboration. And the role assigned to non-government, and this is where we look at roles. So in these partnerships, this demand side or the community mobilization aspect was given to the non-profit sector largely, and even to individual private practitioners to actually provide spacing methods and perform sterilizations if they had the capacity to do so. Now, what is very important in all these relationships is the government was the more powerful agent. It set the terms of engagement with the non-profit and for-profit. And the collaborations were very simple. The government gave some incentives, could have been in cash and even in kind, because they gave intrauterine devices, etc. to do that. So the rhetoric that these that informed these collaborators, interestingly, I mean, I'm not going into it, but there's something that Manu and I have written on, is using the idea of nation building. So collaborations for nation building was one of the ideas that were, I'm going to leave these slides here so you can look at this, but essentially what, this is from an earlier work we had done, where we are doing a summary of public-private collaborations and partnerships, and you would see when the term partnership comes in. So if you look at the first five plans, you will clearly see what I had mentioned earlier of national health programs and largely the NGOs, the non-profit sector. Then when you go into the sixth plan, you start seeing the encouraging private medical professionals to get it. Again, you'll see it in the tuberculosis program, you'll see it in the leprosy program, a lot of the collaborations. In fact, Sehat has done a lot of work in this area. And then when you keep going into the 8th and subsequently to the 9th, 10th and 11th, 12th plans, you start seeing the role of the private sector come in quite significantly. And then, of course, we have a presentation on the NUHM where you find PPPs become institutionalized. So you really have seen the way in which PPP models have come in. And PPP, if you look at the 11th plan, comes in for setting a range of partnerships, which include clinical, diagnostic, radiological services. And then in later on, in fact, more recently, the contracting out of workers. So the casualization of health workforce through a PPP mode becomes very significant. Now I'll just move into the practice of PPPs. And here, again, conceptually, there are two forms. One is the contractual and the other is the institutional. And I think we heard a lot about the institutional part in the education presentation. In healthcare, contractual partnerships are the dominant forms of partnerships. And these could cover a whole range from financing to diagnostic, non-clinical services, emergency services, and more recently, human resources. And I'm not going into great detail because I know there are going to be presentations which are going to specifically look at this. So you're going to be looking at maternal health services, telemedicine as another very important area, mobile health services, etc. And more recently, cash transfer schemes and now the targeted health, public health insurance. And the contracting in and out of diagnostics in non-clinical services at secondary and tertiary care. Now, institutional PPPs are different, and institutional PPPs have been formed when the government jointly creates institutions. And I've just given an example of the Apollo Indraprastha Hospital in Delhi, where land is given on lease, and we heard about that from your presentation as well, where you gave it for a lease for 99 years. And then the infrastructure is created by the, and like in education, there is a caveat that 30% of inpatient and outpatient care has to be provided free. This has not happened despite courts coming in. And what is very important about all these partnerships is that it involves multiple actors. So you're having multiple actors, and then the government, non-profit and for-profits jointly providing services. So each of these actors are getting transformed through the process of commercialization, something that Madhu will be talking about in the presentation. So what are the outcomes of PPPs? One, there is plurality in the type of PPPs in health. And what is very important is the social, political and institutional context of these partnerships, which determines their success or failure. And I think what are the necessary and sufficient conditions for a partnership to actually be forged, to survive, and then to show some form of outcomes. And most PPPs in health tend to be short-term relationships. And I think we've seen that even in the education sector. And our earlier study and review suggests that the reason this happens is the contracts are never for more than 9 months to a year. So there is a lot of rent-seeking and corruption that comes into awarding contracts and also renewal of contracts. And we've done some interviews with NGOs, etc., who really find this a very insecure partnership. They feel that it is a very unfair partnership. And given the specialized need for health services, the pool for selecting private partners is very small. So, you know, there are some activities where you need specialized skill personnel, and very often you don't get it. So you make do with what you get, and that often has ramifications for quality. The government usually is the dominant partner, and we examined some MOUs where clearly the terms of conditions are skewed towards the government, and the government is the awarding agency, so therefore, you know, they have great power in controlling the private sector. And there is considerable amount of corruption and lack of transparency in the award of contracts. Now, unlike education, I think I have only one more slide. PPPs have tended to split roles within the health service system. So we are not just looking at curative care, but we are looking at health service system which has preventive, curative, promotive and rehabilitative services. And the focus of PPPs is mostly in curative services for very specific interventions. In preventive services, they are limited to mostly demand generation, while the supply side is again largely controlled by the public. So what happens is you create a demand, but the public sector is not responding to the demand. Somebody was talking about the users, what do they feel? So there is a lot of a sense of being let down. You're saying I should do all of this, I will get all of this, and I go there and I don't get it. So this question of exclusion comes in a very, very important way. And this results in power imbalances in the partnership itself. Now the point I want to make in health is the technical and the science is controlled by the medical profession. Now you don't have an intermediary who plays such a powerful role, because teachers essentially don't play that role. But in healthcare, the technical and science is controlled by the medical profession, while the behavioral dimension is the responsibility of community organization. And this is especially the case in preventive partnerships. And then what we also find is the plurality of actors involved in the partnerships have varying degrees of power, which often leads to conflicts and contestations within the partnership. And this also results in the fragmentation of authority in the system. So while you may say this, the government is in control, in effect it may not be in control, because that is also being contested by the private parties in some ways. And there are huge challenges for governance, the architecture of governance of PPPs and the decision making that is, you know, the spaces for decision making among these various actors is also something that is worth studying, and we did that for some specific program. From an earlier idea, earlier study, we observed there was no common idea of a common good. That is, it's not as if in the partnership there is an understanding on the part of the person who engages in it, what is the common good. It is the case that even with non-profits, very often they enter into these because they have to become financially sustainable, or they feel they can, in a sense, you know, influence the government to become a bit more sensitive. So I think we cannot sort of generalize on that. There have been many, many experiences, varied experiences on this issue. And the specific, whenever you've had best practices being showcased, especially in health of partnerships, they are very specific to a particular program and much dependent on the actors involved. And I very quickly want to say that, you know, when you have a successful partnership with an NGO, very often you do not realize the amount of energy and work that is done by the NGO to build trust with communities, which then, you know, translate, if you have a good supply side with the government, actually becomes a successful experiment. But you need those necessary and sufficient conditions to be able to replicate and upscale it. And clearly, one of the major learnings of all PPPs in health is replication and upscaling have not been possible. And therefore, the PPPs therefore become limited from a systemic perspective. And I want to make that point that we are looking at. So, from a public health perspective, we have to consider the needs of large populations and systems that can address these needs. PPPs have to be located and studied within this perspective. So, we cannot have one successful PPP to say that, you know, it will work and have a systemic impact. the successful PPPs have not been defined, have been defined not only in terms of their innovation, but also about the characteristics of the partners. So, you know, you read PPP best practice literature, you say, oh, this is a great innovation, but we get no idea about who these actors were, what was their history, and what was their contribution earlier, which makes it work. And then lastly, how do the various forms of PPP strengthen systems that translate, and these are the parameters I think would be important for our measurement, in accessibility, accountability, equity, quality, and trust. And I want to bring back the concept of trust into this discourse, because very often we've forgotten that public systems have also been denuded of trust. And commercialization has been a very, very important factor in the way in which people perceive public systems. Public systems perceive themselves, and the government and the policy makers perceive the public system. So the you started with that first point. We have to interrogate what does publicness mean. And I think we don't have a common, I think there will be very many varied understandings of what constitutes the public. Thank you.